Ladies and gentlemen, I'm really happy to be here and share a few thoughts with you. But I will start first with two excuses. Yeah, the talk I'm going to give is about transformation of ordinary consciousness into the consciousness of Buddha. So honestly speaking, unfortunately, in my case, I didn't manage so far. So this will be theoretical lecture. And yeah, as one Tibetan Lama told me once that, you know, there is a fundamental difference between professors and the yogis. Professors, they live with making simple things complicated, and the yogis, they live with making complicated things simple. So unfortunately, I'm in the first category, so you will suffer a bit, but only 15 minutes, yeah? And the next excuse is that I have only one slide, which, like comparing to everybody who talked before me, it looks really poor, and it looks really small. I'm not sure whether you are able to see what is there, but okay. But at least you will see that there are some red spots and black spots, and so I'm going to talk about these two. So, okay, this few thoughts that I will share with you actually came to my mind when I was translating the commentaries to Namshi Yeshe, like very famous text by Third Karmapa. And in a way, like if we understand what is Namshe and what is Yeshe, actually we understand more or less what Buddhism is all about. So one can say that because actually, if we think that if we say that Buddhism is the way from samsara to nirvana, then defining samsara, we can define it as that which is perceived by conditioned ordinary consciousness, and samsara is what is perceived by yeshe, by the consciousness of the Buddha. So actually Buddhism is, if Buddhism is about going from samsara to nirvana, actually it's not any like path that leads from one realm to the other, but actually it is the transformation of the way we perceive phenomena. So in this way, these two small concepts, these two small words actually cover to large extent a lot of Buddhist view. So let me start with Namshe. This Namshe and Yeshe, there are a few translations in the West, and I guess Namshe is usually translated as consciousness simply, and Yeshe is translated as wisdom. But unfortunately, if we translate it in this way, we lose something really important. What they have in common, both this Namshe and Yeshe, is the type of Shepa consciousness. And when we say that Namshe is consciousness and Yeshe is wisdom, then we lose this obvious thing, which is seen when we read Tibetan text, which I think is crucial. I will not maybe go into what does the verb share means. This is this non-volitional verb, which is also like very interesting topic, but it's large enough to fill another paper. But I will concentrate on these two prefixes, which actually makes the make the difference between these two words, namshe and yeshe. Actually, what is the difference then between these two types of consciousnesses? I rather don't use the word wisdom, because in Slavic languages, for example, wisdom is mainly associated with like a lot of information which is stored on our hard disk. But Yeshe refers to the state of mind that shows us or reveals us the way things are. So I prefer rather to say that this is primordial consciousness or Buddha consciousness than wisdom. So let me start with Namshe first. So what is Namshe? Namshe is what we are using now. If you hear me, it means you use your hearing consciousness, and this is your conditioned consciousness. If you see me, you use your visual conditioned consciousness. I hope you cannot smell me. In case you can, you would use the conditioned consciousness of the smell. So this is what is at work in our everyday experience. We communicate with the help of Namsha, of our conditioned consciousness. So why I call it, why I dare to translate it as conditioned consciousness? Exactly because of this small prefix nam. What does the nam mean? This is translation of Sanskrit prefix v, which in this case means, for example, the dividing consciousness, the consciousness that introduces or it's based on the division into subject and object. So of course this conditioned consciousness is dualistic. It means nampa means also an aspect, and here this is this word aspect nampa in Tibetan always goes in contrast to ngowo, to the essence. So aspect is usually something very superficial, and ngowo is this essence or this essential part of the thing. So namparshepa is the type of consciousness that captures only, let's say, superficial layer of phenomena. It does not reach emptiness, and of course that's why this is the consciousness that actually provides us with completely false knowledge, because it does not reach the essence of phenomena. So in this way one can say that this is superficial consciousness. Also this nampa, like if you want to make the difference between samsara and nirvana, we can say that in essence samsara and nirvana of course are the same, because they are the same way empty, but the difference of course, as Gampopa says, comes with the aspect. The aspect of samsara is that samsara arises as suffering. So in this way we have namparshepa, which grasps the aspect, this samsaric aspects, let's say. This is the consciousness that makes us specialists in suffering, yeah? Because actually the only object this consciousness can capture is the suffering. Also this word nampa you can take also as like the collecting things. And what is collected here, this consciousness can arise only when conditions come together. There must be conditions coming together, conditions collected for this consciousness to arise. What are these conditions? Like roughly, very generally speaking, of course there must be an object and our ability to perceive and our the sense that works properly. When they come together, when this collection is there, then on top of this we have the consciousness, this conditioned consciousness arising. And the last thing one can I can say about this nampar, this prefix nampar, actually very often you know it when we translate the verbs which have this prefix, this nampar means gives us the feeling of fullness of the action expressed by the verb. So in this case it will be like complete consciousness, which at first sounds nice, but this is the consciousness that is completely developed out of karmic seeds. So it means it's like completely samsaric, completely conditioned consciousness, and thus this is not the consciousness to be happy with. So this is the concept of very shortly explain the concept of conditioned consciousness, and this is, let's say, our departure point, because this is what this is actually the description of our state, this dualistic consciousness aiming at object, taken as mistakenly as outer entity. So our point of our destination point in Buddhist practice is Yeshe, the I call it primordial consciousness. And here of course again the whole clue, maybe not the whole clue but important information is given by prefix ye. Most of you know that this is just an abbreviation of yene or yedomane. It means from the very beginning, yeah? So this is the consciousness which is there from the very beginning, but what Tibetan means saying from the very beginning. Of course, he means that there is no beginning, actually, because this is permanent or primordial consciousness in a sense that is completely beyond time. Actually, it has no beginning. It never started because, like, to have the beginning, it means to have the beginning in some conditions coming together. So if this consciousness is without this beginning, this initial collection of conditions, it means actually that this is permanent. It can never fall apart exactly because there are no conditions that that will go apart sooner or later. So this is primordial, primordial consciousness that actually is beginningless, timeless, or one can maybe say better, it's beyond time. Yeah. This prefix "ye" gives us also like the same idea, more or less as Tibetan "tsawa," the core. This is the expression used very often in philosophical texts when you address something really crucial, really important. Then you speak about the core of the things. Tsawa, so it's a kind of, let's say, core consciousness or crucial consciousness, one can say. The other idea is that this is the translation of Sanskrit Adi, which means, let's say, principle, like we have Adi Buddhas. So this is a principle consciousness. Also, we can translate it as ultimate or definite consciousness. Is the consciousness which is always the way it is. It's never changed. And this "ye" also can be taken, as far as I know, as the synonym of "nepar," which gives us the idea that this is true, authentic consciousness. So. But what is important is that they both are consciousnesses. It means they have something in common. What they have in common is just the act of being conscious, yes? So one can say, like, from this point of view, that actually we are already Buddhas, we just perceive things in a wrong way. Or one can say we perceive nirvana non-professionally, yeah, and because we use namshe instead of yeshe, so when we are not professionals in perceiving nirvana, it looks like samsara, yeah. But when we will switch our perception to professional mode, it means we attain yeshe, or we transform namshe into yeshe. Then samsara turns out to be nirvana we didn't recognize before. So of course, how to do it? Yeah, first. So first of all, you have to have, let's say, like, solid basis to do it. It means the knowledge that samsara actually is nirvana, that samsara is what is perceived by namshe and nirvana is what is perceived by yeshe. This knowledge in Tibetan is called psherap, is down there on the bottom of my scheme. And here again we have she, again the same root, namshe, yeshe, and here we have psherap. Psherap is like what we are perfectly conscious of. Yeah, if we have this knowledge, only when we have this view, this actually share up is the content of Tawa, only then we can, let's say, go this way, yeah, because we have a clear map in our mind. And then we just only need the bridge to go through from Namshe to Yeshe. So what is this bridge? This bridge, I guess, is She Shin. This is again... just this ending shin is like ing in English. Sheshin is like permanent state of being aware. Like I could say consciousnessing if I don't offend any English speakers. But this is the constant process of being aware, no matter what we are aware of. The object here is not important, just because we emphasize by staying conscious, we emphasize exactly this thing that connects our present state, namshe, with yeshe. So we, let's say, extract from namshe this root that is there also in yeshe, in the state of Buddha, and this is our bridge. We go from one consciousness to the other. And now we can see that in Tibet, the beauty of Tibetan philosophy and the beauty of this philosophical language is that these four terms fit perfectly. We have namshe, our conditioned consciousness, we have Sherab, what we are perfectly conscious of as the basis, Yeshe as the point or the destination point, this perfect state of being aware without any object, or being aware in a non-dual way, and then the bridge there, which is Sheshin, the state of being aware, which emphasizes what connects Namshe with Yeshe. So I think this is very nice and clear scheme, which is lost in English translation when we translate Namshe as consciousness, Yeshe as wisdom, Sherab as knowledge, and Sheshin as mindfulness. Everywhere we have all kind of words, but we lose the most important thing for Buddhist practice and for being the Buddha, Shepa, the state of being aware, which is perfectly from the very beginning, yeah, because this is non-volitional verb showing us that this activity is spontaneous, happens by itself, mind is just there, being aware, and of course in Mahamudra we will elaborate that this is the state of being aware is like the awareness of in the way of clear light, Özel, which is one of the most beautiful metaphors ever used in English, in Buddhism, yeah, because light reveals the object as consciousness do, but light reveals itself as well as the mind do. Yeah, mind reveals the object and reveals itself. So in this She, which is clear light, this perfect state of Buddha, of self-aware Buddha is already contained, is already there. And if we just define meditation as Sheshin and Drenpa, which means mindfulness and Drenpa, like remembering, having this mind frame of Tawa in our mind, when they come together, we go quickly, I hope, from Namshe to Yeshe, which I wish you all from the depth of my heart.
Thank you.
Thank you for your patience.